So molecules are two atoms bonded together, and a macromolecule is just a very, very large molecule. So it's going to be made of hundreds or thousands of atoms bonded together rather than just one or two atoms bonded together. While that sounds like a huge molecule that would be difficult to understand, it's actually made of smaller repeating units that we call monomers. And remember, in Latin, mono means one and mer means unit. So here's a simple example of the structure of a monomer and a polymer. A monomer is a single molecule that's made of these three atoms bonded together. And if we're going to make a polymer, or a macromolecule, a large molecule, we're going to take these same three in repeating units and make a big chain of them. So you can see it's a large molecule, but it's actually made of four of the same repeating units. Poly is Latin for many. So this has many parts, but they're just repeating parts. This is glucose. Glucose is one of our key monomers, and we're going to use this molecule to build longer chains, branch chains, circles of large macromolecules. If we take this main circle and put it in a chain, and then put that chain into these loops, we have amylose. If we take the very same circle and put it in branched chains, we have glycogen. Amylose is part of starch that plants produce, and glycogen is an alternative way for animals to store energy. We store a lot of glycogen in our liver and a little bit in our muscle tissue. So, same base, but we've built two totally different things with that same monomer. So how do molecules change? They change through chemical reactions. And a chemical reaction is defined as a change in matter involving energy where bonds between atoms are created or broken. And we use chemical equations as a written summary of a chemical reaction to explain which molecules are reactants and are bumping into each other, and then what's the product of that? Are they building something bigger or are they coming apart? And here's an example of a chemical equation. So in this particular chemical reaction, we have this molecule, glucose, which is a fairly simple molecule. It's got a few more atoms than water or oxygen gas, but fairly simple. And we're going to react that with oxygen, and we're going to end up with carbon dioxide, water, and some ATP. So here we have our reactants, and here we have our products. And this is just representing a set of chemical reactions. So biomolecules are very large macromolecules that are absolutely essential for life. And you'll hear me interchange the words macromolecule and biomolecule. And because I'm a biologist, I'm generally, when I'm talking about macromolecules, I am talking about one of the four key biomolecules that we need for life. So those four are carbohydrates, nucleic acids, proteins, and lipids. And you've heard of most of these, right? They're important components of food, and hopefully that makes sense. What we eat in our food is what we need to live. I want to show you a typical cell. You don't have to memorize these numbers, but this is just to give you a sense. A typical cell will be about 60% protein. And if you look at the protein, it's spread throughout the cell. So it's going to be part of the cytoskeleton. It's going to be embedded. It's going to be in different organelles and ribosomes throughout the cell. About 10% of the cell is carbs. Now, I think we all think of carbs as something we have a lot of, but carbs provide us energy and we use them up quickly. Instead, if we're saving energy, we're going to save it in the form of a lipid. For cells, this is a plant cell, lots of the lipid is going to be in the cell membrane. And then finally, DNA and RNA, which we'll talk about the function of in a little bit, makes up about 25% of a typical cell. before we talk about the characteristics of each individual kind of biomolecule, here are some characteristics that they all have in common. First, they're all organic molecules. And what organic means chemically is that they contain carbon. This is different from the meaning of an organic walnut or organic apple. That has a legal definition and has to do with pesticide use and fertilizers. This just means there is carbon involved. They're all macromolecules, meaning they have generally smaller units that are repeating. And they all have this structure of a carbon skeleton with an attached R group. And let me show you what I mean by that. This is a simple fat molecule, true fat. And notice that we have this huge line of carbons. This would be considered the carbon skeleton. If you took the carbons away here, this whole molecule would fall apart. If you took the hydrogens away, this would still be the overall shape. And then you have this R group. You have this attached group hanging off here. And this is what's going to give its chemical characteristics. So the skeleton gives the overall structure, and then the attached groups give it its chemical unique characteristics. Why does carbon make such a good building block? Well, it turns out because of where it is on the periodic table, it forms very strong, very reliable bonds. It's good at sharing its electrons. It's happy to bond with other things. It's able to bond to four different atoms at the same time, and that allows you to build into three dimensions instead of just one or two. Here we have a simple carbon atom, and notice it can bond to four different groups, and it can bond to very different groups, other carbons, hydrogens, oxygens, nitrogens, and it just makes a really solid building block. Here we can see carbons have been built into long strings. If you have a double bond, which carbon is happy to form between two carbons, this is even a stronger bond. It actually prevents the adjacent carbons from rotating. Around this bond, this side of the chain and this side of the chain can rotate, but double bonds keep the carbon chain in a certain orientation. So you can get straight lines, you can get branches. It also turns out you can get these nice circles. At each one of these corners, there is a carbon atom, and you can see that creates the structure. And then we have these little R groups hanging off that give this particular molecule its different chemical characteristics.